Hello, everyone. Welcome to RNAO's Small Talk with, this week we are talking with Morgan Hoffarth, president of RNAO. We are thrilled to have Morgan in this conversation. She's always a great speaker and have very insightful thoughts regarding healthcare issues. So, Morgan, how's it going?
It's good. It's going well. Thanks, Raul. I'm so excited to be joining you.
Yes, thank you. And before asking you about a topic today, which is Bill 124, I would like to ask you for a couple of minutes about you. Tell us a little bit about your call to be a healthcare worker, to be a nurse, and when did this started? When did you decided to work in this area, and how is it going so far?
Thanks. So I currently work as a director of care at a long-term care home. Initially, when I went to university, I thought that I would either be a physiotherapist or a high school gym teacher. So I started my post-secondary studies actually as a kinesiology student at Wilfrid Laurier University. And during one of my kinesiology classes, we had a presentation by a nurse from Grand River Hospital who was talking about what it meant to be a nurse, what her job was like, the different roles that nurses play. And that presentation really inspired me to change my career path. And within the week had applied to a nursing program. So decided that nursing sounded like it really was the best fit for what I wanted to do. So I wanted to be part of making people healthier and helping them to live healthy, fulfilled lives, no matter what that meant to them. So I wanted to help people meet their goals of achieving what their kind of optimal health status was, and decided in that moment that I should become a nurse. So I've worked in many different areas during my career as a nurse. I've worked in primary care. I worked in the hospital acute care sector. I worked in rehab. I work in long-term care. So I've had a lot. I worked in mental health. I've had a lot of different experiences, all that have really helped me to grow as a nurse and as a person, and to be better able to help the communities or residents or people that I help take care of.
Have you been living the process of working at your current job and also working as a person of RNAO during this pandemic? It's been challenging, I guess, but can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, it definitely has been challenging. So I was actually just talking to another nurse leader about how the pandemic makes just everything a bit more challenging, and the typical life stressors and other things that happen that we normally would be able to deal with no problem just seems so much worse because they're compounded with living through a pandemic for the past like 20 months. So it has been, initially, I would say the pandemic was actually really exciting. It felt like we were all working together for the greater good to really accomplish something. And we're like, yes, let's go hard for the next 6 weeks and we'll wipe this out. And now we're 20 months into the pandemic and it continues to ravage our healthcare system and has really been exhausting. So I consider myself lucky that I have been able to continue to work throughout the pandemic. I don't know that my personality is well suited to working from home or being at home. So I'm very thankful that I have a career that's allowed me to continue to go to work every day, even though sometimes I think, wouldn't it be great if I was working from home right now? I am very thankful that I've been able to continue to go to work. And I've had the good fortune of being part of several really great teams during the pandemic that have kept things kind of interesting and new. So initially during the pandemic, I was redeployed from my role in complex care to open a pandemic surge unit, which initially was intended to be for people who had COVID but didn't need acute care. They needed supportive care. They needed to be in a hospital setting, but in post-acute care would be okay for them. So I spent the first kind of week and a half of the pandemic getting ready for that, ordering the supplies, opening a unit that had been closed for 5 years. And then when it came time to admit, we shifted to be a subacute medicine unit. So it was not people who had COVID. It was individuals who were in acute care who were waiting for long-term care beds. So I did that for the initial probably 4 months of the pandemic, which was exciting. It was great to work with a team of healthcare professionals. So nurses, PSWs, rehab therapists, occupational therapists, physiotherapists, social workers, who were redeployed from different areas to all come together and provide the best possible experience we could for these people who were kind of displaced from where they were and waiting to go to their final destination. So it was a really great experience, and I really enjoyed working with that diverse group of people who, although they weren't in the place that they were hired to work or maybe wanted to work, they all had really great attitudes and really approached it from a place of positivity, which I'm very, very grateful and thankful for. And then I went back to my own role in complex care and worked doing more of my usual job during a pandemic. There was some pandemic pieces associated with that, but it was back to kind of more my regular job. And then I made the decision to come and work as a director of care in long-term care. And I have been in this role for almost 1 year. November 2nd, 2020, I started as the director of care, and I'm really enjoying working in the long-term care setting. It is challenging with the pandemic. There's lots of different directives that are changing. And lots of things that we need to make sure that we are meeting requirements the ministry has, while also providing the best possible quality of care and experience for our residents. But I'm really thankful that I'm in long-term care. I really love working with our residents, working with the nursing department here, as well as our therapeutic programs department, to make sure that we really are doing what's best for residents. And I think that there's such great opportunity in long-term care to make a significant difference in the way that both we view long-term care as a place to work, but also as a place to live for our people who need that kind of 24/7 residential supportive care. So I'm really excited about the future of long-term care. And I think having a couple different opportunities during the pandemic, although it's really hard to get to know your coworkers when you can't see their faces or spend any time with them outside of work, or even do some of the more like social things that we would have done previously. It's difficult to get to know your coworkers on that deeper personal level, but it has been really great to have the opportunity to do different things during the pandemic.
Well, your experiences in different setups, in different medical centers, and now in long-term care probably give you enough credit to talk about Bill 124, which is, I've been reading about it. It sounds very odd to me in many ways. It doesn't seem to be like a complete well-prepared bill. It's very strange. And of course, if it's upsetting, the fact that it capped the earnings the nurses and healthcare workers can receive every year, is even more upsetting that there are some other essential workers that are exempt of this. So about the bill itself, what are your thoughts on this, and what do you think is going to happen?
Yeah, I agree that Bill 124 was not a very well put together or thought out bill on behalf of our government. I think it is very wrong to include some public sector employees and exclude others. particularly because of the, when we look at gender discrimination, majority, not all, but majority of healthcare workers are female, and nurses and other healthcare workers, Build 124 caps their ability to collectively bargain for increased wages, which are very well deserved by all of our healthcare providers, and other public sector employees like firefighters or police officers don't have that same, they're not covered by Bill 124. So when we talk about our frontline workers and our nurses and our other healthcare workers being heroes during this pandemic, it really is a slap in the face to call somebody a hero, but then not treat them and reward them the same way as we do other professions that we also consider to be heroic. So I think it really has, in addition to the pandemic, it has caused a lot of moral distress and angst and upset amongst healthcare workers who are doing their very best, are working hard, are working extra hours, are working short, are working overtime without the ability to collectively bargain or without the ability to have an increase in their salary that even matches the cost of living increase that we are experiencing. It really is difficult to be motivated to continue to work in a profession that is very challenging, that is dangerous to work in without having the adequate compensation for doing that work.
There's this small amount of healthcare workers who refuse to vaccinate. They said this is their right to do it, to reject it. And they also using this argument about being called heroes last year and this year being obligated, right, or being mandated to do this, which is against them. About the role of healthcare workers and the call to be a public servant, we understand that every job deserves to be, to have, you know, if I work, I want to get paid. I understand that, right? But the balance between the job and the call is something that is interesting to me, not being a healthcare worker. And again, I'm not trying to empathize, I'm trying to agree with them, but trying to get just some understanding of what's going on. Thankfully, they're just only a handful of people in this situation right now, but I don't know, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think that there are many vaccinations that we have been required to get as healthcare workers in order to get hired. So when I got hired to my job, I had to provide proof that I was immune to measles, mumps, rubella, and varicella, as well as have a TB skin test. I understand the perspective of those are all well-established vaccines, or for me, I'm too old to be vaccinated against chickenpox, so it's natural immunity that I acquired, but there I did have to have blood work to demonstrate that I was immune to chickenpox when I was hired. So I think it's vitally important as people who are working with vulnerable populations that we are doing everything that we can to help keep ourselves safe and healthy so that we are able to go to work and provide that care to our patients, residents, communities, depending on where you work and what you call them, but also to do everything that we can to help protect those people. It is vitally important that people get their vaccination, and I understand that some people don't want it, and they have a really difficult choice to make about whether they are going to get a vaccine that they may not necessarily agree with and continue to work in their role in healthcare, or whether they are not going to get it and are going to have to figure out what an alternative path for them is. So I recognize it is a really difficult decision for those who are opposed to vaccination, but it is one that they are going to be required to make.
Yes, excellent. And well, finally, I would like you to have a couple of seconds to address your fellow colleagues, to invite them to sign the action letter the RNAO has set up against Bill 124, looking to just repeal the bill. and moving forward from that. So I'm getting out of this video so you can send these greetings to your colleagues and call them to support this action.
To ask the Premier and government to repeal Bill 124. It's vitally important that you sign and also that this bill gets repealed. So please go to the RNAO website and sign the action alert to repeal Bill 124.
This has been a small talk with Morgan Hoffarth. We're really happy to have you here. And again, we invite everybody to share, to like, to comment, and please let us know about the topics that you want to talk in the following weeks. Morgan, thank you for your time.
Thank you.